For joining us for this session, it's entitled Muscle Fiber Types Specific Insights on Muscle Function and Metabolism. So firstly, thanks to the organisers for arranging this conference, and congratulations on making it work at such a challenging time. Disappointed though, we're not all together in Spain, but hopefully the next conference we'll be able to get together. So we've got three speakers in this session, myself and Robin, who are currently in Australia, in each of our homes, and we have Vicky, who's an Australian but currently in Sweden. So particularly me and Robin, I think, appreciate the organisers arranging this talk at a sociable time for us here in Australia. So let's get started. I think I'll introduce Professor Murphy, who's the Associate Head of School, School of Life Sciences at La Trobe University. And she's going to cover some of her pioneering work with a particular focus on muscle fiber type specific analysis. Thanks, Robin.
Thanks, Chris. And I certainly echo your words about the organisation, and the fact that we can still hold this conference is a great thing, and the hour at which we speak, and it's 6 o'clock or 6:15 here in Australia. So I'm going to really introduce this session and talk about the cellular approach to muscle analyses and look at advances that are leading to greater mechanistic insight. So skeletal muscle will be the tissue that I'm talking about, simply because it's the one that I'm interested in when we exercise. And I really come in from a biochemical approach when I consider muscle and exercise. And so one of the things about exercise and muscle is that when we do exercise, the metabolic demands of muscle can go up dramatically, up to 100-fold increases. And part of that is going to be particular to a particular muscle fibre type that we're looking at. So in this cross-section here, I quite like it from Val Fiardo, with the colours that they have, showing that type 1 muscle fibres sit side by side with type 2A muscle fibres and type 2X muscle fibres. And these differ in both their metabolic properties as well as their contractile properties. And it's because of the myosin heavy chain present that they are called those fiber types. Now, ATP consumption occurs for many different reasons inside skeletal muscle, and some of these will be around protein synthesis and ionic homeostasis, which are both extremely important for muscle function. But the large proportion of ATP consumption in muscle is going to be due to the activities of three major ATPases. And these are the sarcoplasmic reticulum, calcium ATPase, or the circ pumps, the myosin ATPases, and the sodium potassium ATPases. And I want to show you this schematic, and it's the surface membrane is at the top here, and the deep invaginations in skeletal muscle where we propagate our action potentials, the T systems, indicated here. And sitting on both of these membranes is where we have our sodium potassium ATPase pumps. Inside the muscle, we have the sarcoplasmic reticulum, and this is where the calcium is released from when you have excitation-contraction coupling, but crucial to relaxation following muscle contraction when the calcium is released is the activity of the circ pump as it takes the calcium back up into the SR. And the activity of the circ pump goes up dramatically with exercise. And down here, we have our contractile apparatus, and the myosin ATPase requires the ATP for the relaxation of the muscle contraction as well. So through these processes, we can start to think about where the differences are in muscle. So where's the muscle heterogeneity when we consider these parts of muscle? And once again, if we have a look at Val's picture here, we see that they're sitting side by side. But what my lab does is we look at muscle fibres as a distinct entity and not when they're sitting side by side. So we dissect the muscle fibres out, but using the same antibodies, we can detect whether or not a particular muscle fibre that is loaded onto a gel is containing myosin heavy chain type 2 or type 1 or a combination of both, which is what's shown here. And likewise, those same muscle fibres can now be looked at for the presence of a multitude of proteins. And so here we can see that circle 1, which is the fast switch isoform of circa, is present when you have myosin heavy chain 2, and circa 2 is present when you have myosin heavy chain 1, or you have a combination. So here, our sarcoplasmic reticulum is also fiber type dependent. What I'm not going to include in the presentation is that the sodium potassium pump, there's many different isoforms. Some of them are fiber type specific and some are not. But I don't have time to show all of those types of data. But Vicky's got a lot of publications in this area. We also have proteins such as calsequestrin, which is the calcium binding protein sitting within the SR. These have fiber type specific isoforms, and also our troponin protein. So those sitting over here at the contractile apparatus, allowing the contractions to occur by removing the inhibition of tropomyosin, they are isoform specific as well, dependent on fiber type. So clearly, if we want to understand what any of these particular proteins is doing, we will get more information if we look at the individual fiber types. What I want to do is just hone in now on the circa for a moment and just describe a scenario that we were quite intrigued by. And that is that the circa activity, which is what these numbers are representing here, increase when you go from a type 1 through to a type 2X muscle fibre. And if we just have a, actually, let me just go back. If we have a look at the type 2A muscle fibres here and the type 2X, you see an almost threefold increase in the ATPase rate, but is this down to the circa present? And certainly it's not due to the circa abundance. So this is work from Barney Frankish's PhD thesis, where Barney looked at a whole combination of individual muscle fibres. He looked at them all through Western blotting, as you see here on the right-hand side, and he plotted the abundance of circle 1, so the fast twitch isoform, to see whether or not this was going to explain this activity, a difference in the abundance. Now, pure 2X fibres are reasonably difficult to come across, and this is actually a diseased model where we found an abundance of these pure 2X fibres. But you can see that the difference in circa abundance is minimal compared to the fact that we've got a threefold difference in activity here. And very nicely, we see in the example Western blot that if you have a 2X muscle fibre and you have circle 1, the abundance of this circle 1 is very similar in this fibre here, which is a 2A muscle fibre. So the activity of the circle 1 must be what's being regulated here. So what we know about a couple of proteins that regulate circa activity are two key players, one called phospholamban and one called sarcolipin. Now, the roles of these are defined in the literature, but I don't think that we have them very well defined at the moment. But certainly their involvement in regulating calcium uptake and hence the activity of the circa, there seems to be a connection. Phospholamban was thought to be only abundant in slow twitch muscle fibres. It was first identified in cardiac muscle, and sarcolipin was therefore considered a fast twitch counterpart. But what Barney did in the same type of experiments was looked at the abundance of monomeric phospholamban I'm showing here and sarcolipin on the right. And if we're just looking at the type 2A fibres or the type 2X fibres, you'll see that there is a difference in terms of the abundance of phospholamban. So there seems to be less inhibition of the circa from phospholamban in our 2X fibres and a very similar abundance of sarcolipin. And you can see that we haven't got nearly as many N values for the sarcolipin, but there doesn't seem to be a difference. So the explanation of how we've got a threefold difference in activity of circa, whilst it's been considered that it's likely to be phospholamban and sarcolipin, I think that the jury has to remain out on that until we get more information about when these proteins are associated, and they can be regulated by different metabolically regulated factors inside the muscle. So once again, it brings me to the fact that if we have a muscle sample, then the heterogeneity of that muscle sample is best to be considered. And here, just from many, many different individuals and the data pulled together, you can see that most people will have an abundance of type 1 muscle fibres that is slightly greater than those of type 2. But if we take different cohorts of individuals, then those differences are different. So here we've got just a comparison of how many type 1 muscle fibres are in a given group of individuals in the white and the type 2 muscle fibres in the dark bars, and whether they be an older individual or whether they be young, their training status is going to dictate how many type 1 versus type 2 muscle fibers there are. And certainly type 2 diabetes, there's also an effect on fiber type abundance. So as soon as we have a difference in the abundance and we want to look at a particular protein, if we take it from an older individual, whether they go from an untrained to a trained status, then the change that we see in a given protein, we have to question, is that because we've had a shift in the fiber type when we have these fiber-specific proteins that we're examining? And that is a lot of the work that gets done in the laboratory in Melbourne. So one of the first things that I did many years ago was to really want to answer some questions around fiber heterogeneity by looking at individual muscle fibers. And what I did was not novel in the sense that people had done this many, many years ago. But in the old days, I'll call it, it took a long, long time to do a given study using single muscle fibers. It took in the order of more than 3 years to do a single study to examine the effect of exercise, as an example. So what I was able to do was to refine the technique, and we've done this refinement over many years. And this is the first step where the biopsy is taken from the vastus lateralis, and whether the muscle fibers are isolated under paraffin oil as fresh tissue, and these muscle fibers that remain functional to an electrical impulse. And that's work that comes from the lab where I did my postdoc with Graham Lamb and George Stevenson. So they're quite a functional fiber still, but we can do the biochemistry on those as well as the physiology, or we can take the muscle samples and freeze dry them, which is a great advantage because you can go back to those samples multiple times and take more fibers from them. Once the muscle fibers are collected, then we could run the Western blot and look at the particular proteins that we're interested in. With this technique that I published in 2011, the muscle fibers would be collected individually and then loaded onto the gel. And the advantage here was that the resolution attained was such that you could see a given protein in just that single muscle fiber sample. So it wasn't necessary to take multiple samples of muscle fibers, which is what had been done in the past. But the disadvantage of this was that you didn't have a control over how big the muscle fibers were that you collected. Whilst you might try and collect the same length fiber, it's the diameter of a fiber that has a much greater weighting on the total protein abundance. And you also didn't know what muscle fibers you were going to end up with sitting side by side on that Western blot. But even so, it meant that we could reduce the time of being approximately 3 years down towards about a 6 month period to do a whole study. And that has evolved over the years from when I first published that work. So what it has evolved to now, which I'm really excited about, and this work we published just last year, Danny Christensen is at the University of Copenhagen. He visited the lab as a PhD student. Martin McGuinness has a tenured position at University of Calgary now. He visited me as a postdoc with Marty Gabala. And then together with other people in my lab, we worked towards this refinement of the technique. So the first steps are the same. And the single fibre is collected. But then what we do is we, rather than having to run a gel, which is quite laborious, is that a very small part of that muscle fibre, about a tenth of it, is dotted onto some membrane. And then we can probe for the proteins of interest. And through subsequent protein probing, you can identify the fibres as type 1, type 2A, or type 2X. And 2X had been a little bit of an illusion for us to this point. So we were able to do that. And given that we only qualitatively wanted to know what myosin was present, this was a very acceptable way to do that. And once the fibres were identified, then we could start to put a number of fibres together that were type 1 from a given sample and type 2. And so now, whilst we didn't need the multitude of fibres for resolution, it meant that same sample could now be probed for many, many different proteins on many different occasions. And it also meant that you could really start to design your experiments such that you could have a type 1 muscle fibre next to a type 2, and that might be before exercise, and that might be the samples after exercise. And so you get a very good representation and you span them across the whole gel. Anytime something will come from the lab, you'll essentially see a calibration curve that's been loaded onto the same gel. And through using a calibration curve, we're able to really probe into the quantitative aspect of Western blotting. And what this has done, it means that if somebody who knows how to do the technique comes in with samples from, say, before exercise training and after exercise training from an N of, say, 8 or 10, you can turn the data around in about 6 to 8 weeks. So we've really refined it to make it accessible to those people who are interested in looking at single fiber biochemistry and really addressing heterogeneity. What I want to do is put things into a little bit of a perspective, and a lot of this is published in a review some time ago now with my colleague Graham Lamb. And what we really wanted to point out in this review was some important aspects. One is around loading controls, and this is work that Vicky, who will speak last in the session here, did as part of her PhD. And Vicky looked at muscle samples from older individuals and younger individuals, and she looked at the protein GAPDH. It's a glycolytic enzyme, but people tend to use it as a housekeeping protein, which really perplexes us a little bit. So Vicky has published that if you take samples from these are the young individuals, these are the older individuals, then there is less GAPDH at the whole muscle level. So if you have your housekeeping protein changing, then you have little chance of seeing differences that are real or not real in your protein of interest. And certainly if you look at individual fiber types, type 1 versus type 2, there's around about a twofold difference in the abundance of GAPDH in both muscle samples from young individuals and those from the older individuals. So these differences are very stark and tell us that without a good loading control, you will find differences that are really not there. The other thing is about working in the range that you understand the relationship between the output, which is on the y-axis here, and the input, which is here described as an amount of muscle. This protein that is being shown here is AMPK beta 1, and you can see that these are the loading amounts that are quite low in terms of microgram of wet weight muscle, which if you divide that by 4 gives you the total protein. And up here are values that you probably are used to seeing in the literature. But when you look at that protein and you say, well, I know that there's a fivefold difference in the amount I've loaded from 20 to 100, and you can see that on your total protein gel, the protein of interest has not changed in abundance. So this is what could be a calibration, but rather it's a flat line. So whilst there should be a difference detectable, it won't be detectable because you don't know, or you're not working within a range that you're aware of this relationship. So working down here in this range is where you will be able to detect differences. And so when I talk about single fibre Western blotting, or when we do, we're talking about not only looking at individual fibres, but working within a range that is realistic to be able to detect differences. And it really is about understanding the relationship here. And this work was first published by another PhD student, Janelle Mollica, where we nutted through these types of issues. The other issue that I like to describe is one where people get quite concerned that they can't see their protein of interest because it's so lowly abundant. And in order to see their protein of interest, they do one of two things. One is they will load more sample on their gel, and as they're loading more sample, they actually hinder the ability to see the lowly abundant protein. And in the paper, the review, I described that very clearly. But what they also might do is remove what they say, what they imagine is interrupting or interfering with them being able to see their protein of interest, and that is to get rid of actin and myosin, because that's 80% of the total muscle protein. But the problem is when you remove these proteins, they're quite sticky proteins, in particular actin, proteins of interest also pull down with those samples, with those proteins. So you start to get a misrepresentation of your sample. And this is an example that I've shown in the review here. And this protein just happens to be caveolin 3, and it was published work looking at single fibers from rat muscle. Rat EDL muscle is fast twitch, and rat soleus muscle is slow twitch. And there's around about a twofold difference in the abundance of caveolin 3 protein. But if you do a simple fractionation step to detect caveolin-3, these samples were assessed using Triton, so the cavion 3 should come out of the membrane, but you find a complete opposite compared to how much is actually there. This is probably an extreme case, but if you don't know that you're not getting this type of relationship, then this fractionation can be a problem. So working within a single fibre range is what you can do to avoid some of these potential problems. And this is what we do. And hopefully what I've convinced you of also in terms of understanding skeletal muscle and changes that might happen there is that we need to take into account the very plastic nature of skeletal muscle that we're aware of, and that if we take into account the fibre type composition, then this is when we will really start to understand the mechanism, molecular mechanisms that we need to consider. So here's a study that Vicky did as part of her PhD, and these are the attributes of a group of older individuals and a group of younger individuals who were matched pretty well along the way, and obviously the peak heart rate was not, but other things were matched quite well on VO2. These individuals had a different fibre type composition. These numbers that you see here are not from the full cohort, but this is giving us a representation that the older untrained individuals had a greater abundance of type 1 muscle proteins and compared to the younger trained individuals. What we wanted to do in this particular study was to look at the mitochondrial abundance of the different muscle samples. And so we took, in the first instance, whole muscle samples from older individuals and younger individuals. And throughout the next few data slides, I'm going to show you two proteins. One is NDU-FA9, which is a complex 1 protein. And the other one is cytochrome oxidase 4, which is a complex 4 protein. So two proteins that are considered reasonable markers of mitochondrial abundance. And if we take the samples and we run them with calibration curves on the gels, which are not shown in the representatives here in the paper, but they were on the gels, that there's no statistical difference in the abundance of either FA9 or COX-4. What you do notice is that there is a wider spread in the older individuals, and that's likely due to some changes that are happening in those individuals that is a greater change than what's happening in the younger ones. What Vicky was able to show in this paper is some of the disadvantages of doing fractionation and identified why it was that the mitochondrial abundance has been reported to be different between old and young individuals. And it comes down to some fractionation techniques that gives you differences if you have muscle from old people versus young people. But of course, we want to know what's going on at the single fibre level, and mitochondrial abundance, as we expect, is going to be greater in our slow twitch oxidative type 1 muscle fibres compared to our type 2, which can be oxidative still, but they are they're still the type 2 muscle fibres, so I won't go into that too much. So in the younger individuals, the FA9 is more abundant in the type 1 versus the type 2, which is similar for the COX-4 protein. So that's nothing surprising there. When we looked at the older individuals at the single fibre level, we found that there was, as we saw, no difference in total, but the fibre type specificity of these two proteins remained robust in those individuals. So with the older group of individuals, they then got put through 12 weeks of training, and the training mode there was 4x4 minutes at 90% of their peak heart rate, which was quite extensive for these individuals. And these data shown here are for the whole muscle samples, and it really was to consider whether there was a robust adaptation in these individuals in response to exercise training. And it was perhaps assumed that they might not adapt, and certainly they did. There was an increase in both the FA9 and the COX-4. But of course, what we wanted to know is whether or not what we saw in terms of a fibre type transition, whether that might be part of the explanation here. And it doesn't seem to be, because you're going up with exercise, but your type 1 abundance is going down in this particular case. So not only was the whole muscle looked at, it was looked at the single fibre level. So here you have the representative blots here in the calibration curves, and COX-4 in type 1 fibers at the top and type 2 at the bottom. Both of these saw a significant increase following exercise. And the FA9 was significantly increased in the type 2 muscle fibers, but no difference in the type 1 muscle fibers. So you've got a fiber-specific response for the FA9 and not the COX-4. Martin McGuinness, when he had a really elaborate design, which he did with Marty Kabbalah, and that was with the same individual, they had the two legs exercise trained differently. There was high-intensity interval training on one leg, and on the other leg it was matched for work, but it was done over a longer duration at moderate intensity. So what Martin did was to look at the whole muscle, and once again I'm showing you for COX-4 at the top and FA9 at the bottom, and you'll see that there's a training effect for the abundance of these proteins. There was no difference that could be detected for the actual training modality. And in this instance, we weren't able to find a fiber-specific response, and I think it was probably that this duration was only for, I think it was 6 days in total, so it wasn't a high volume over that period of time, the total volume of work, and we didn't see anything more than that training effect at the single fiber level. And then also from Marty's lab, Lawrence, lots of individuals, one cohort underwent sprint interval training, so 3 20-second all-out bouts of exercise, and the other one was the moderate intensity continuous exercise. So similar to the two studies I've just shown you, there was the whole muscle was analysed, and what you'll see for the moderate intensity and the sprint interval training, there was an increase following the training regime in the mixed muscle for COX-4, and this was also seen at the level of FA9. And when we looked at the individual muscle fibre responses, the type 1 is the first graph here, and for COX-4, it is increased with the moderate intensity exercise, but not the sprint exercise. But for the type 2A muscle fibres, where you'd have a greater innervation with the sprint, no doubt, you've got an increase in both fibre types. And this is a similar response in the FA9, where you see it in both fibres. Summary, what I hope that I've shown you is that we certainly are able to get more insight into identifying mechanisms of muscle function, particularly in acute exercise or exercise training, where different muscle fibre types might be recruited. We can do this with single muscle fibre interrogation. Also, hopefully a take-home message is around the being able to quantitatively, it's semi-quantitative still, but it's many steps up from our typical Western blotting, that you can achieve by using a calibrated system. And also that the laborious aspect of single muscle fibre analyses has been dramatically reduced over the past 10 years. And I believe it has made this broadly available now to labs around the world to answer these questions at the single fibre level, should they wish to do so. When Lauren Scully, she spent the last day in the lab by herself, so she did a little chemiluminescence to say thanks. And I thank you also for your attention, and to my lab and my collaborators who I've presented the work of today. So thank you very much.
That's excellent. Thanks, Robin. In the interest of time, we probably have time for one quick question. I don't know if anyone from the panel has a question. So I can ask a quick question, Robin. You've clearly shown the advantage of Western blotting, and you know we've used a lot of immunofluorescence microscopy to measure fiber type, but also fiber type specific abundance of proteins. And do you think that's a valid way to measure protein abundance? And what have you got to say on that?
I think you can't calibrate an immunofluorescence image. And so if you see an intensity that looks like you've got double the fluorescence intensity, is it actually double the abundance? And that's something that is difficult to know, because you can't calibrate the system. So I think it's difficult to say in absolute amounts what's gone on. The other thing that with immunofluorescence is, if you're looking at a protein that is not tightly bound to another structure within the muscle fibre, then when you're doing the first step of washing the muscle, you have the chance that you have washed away proteins of interest. So any cytosolic proteins, and heat shock proteins are a classic example where work that Noni Frankenberg, when she was Noni Larkins, did, she showed that 60% of the heat shock proteins are diffusible. So in a 10-second wash, you've lost 60% of your heat shock protein. And then what you're seeing is what's left in the muscle fiber. Now, if that changes with exercise, and something like heat shock proteins do change, they go and bind in response to particularly damaging exercise, then you're going to find a greater amount appearing there inside the muscle because you've had a shift, but you can't quantitate that because you don't know what you've lost. And that's one of the biggest limitations of using immunofluorescence, and that needs to be, you need to be mindful of that. And then of course antibody validation needs to be done in all situations, but it's difficult to validate an antibody and know that it's only picking up your protein of interest, and denaturing is not the way to necessarily address whether it's the right antibody to use for immunofluorescence. But without a knockout tissue, I would also then question whether or not you're seeing if you know what it is that you're seeing. So it's really around the validation. If you can validate all those things, I'm fine. But if you can't put those steps of validation in, then I then do question it.
Okay. Thanks, Robin. So thanks again for a great talk. But
thanks.
In the time, we have to move on. Okay, so we'll move on, and I'm actually the next speaker. So my name is Chris Shaw. I'm from, sorry, excuse me, just while I share my screen. Okay, so where was I? Yeah, so my name is Chris Shaw. I'm a senior lecturer in exercise physiology at Deakin University. I work within the Institute for Physical Activity and Nutrition Research. So what I'm going to present today are two sides of some of the recent work we've done. Some of the older work is, at least we started a while ago, was focusing on intramuscular lipid metabolism, and then the second part of my talk is really focusing on some more recent work around autophagy in skeletal muscle. So first of all, just acknowledge people in the lab who've helped out with this and done a lot of this work, in particular Gabriella and Jaden and Courtney are in our lab and invested a lot of time, particularly in the single fiber isolation, which we've used to quantify some of these proteins of interest. And also like to send my thanks to Robin as well, who's helped me out a lot since established my lab at Deakin over the last few years. Okay, so what my interest in intramuscular lipids started during my PhD, and the two, I guess, key things that got me interested in intramuscular lipid was its potential role as a fuel source during exercise, but also the fact that it's linked to the development of insulin resistance in skeletal muscle, at least in sedentary individuals. And as we learn more about the role of lipids, and in particular lipid droplets, we now know that the role of lipids goes much further than just being a storage site for excess lipid, and just appears like it could play a role, at least in various cellular processes, which I'm not going to cover today. Which focus of this talk is really going to focus on the role of intramuscular lipid during the exercise. So this is a part of the data from a systematic review we've been putting together this year with Jaden from our lab. So what we've done is we've accumulated all the data from exercise studies that have measured the change in intramuscular triglyceride content in response to an acute exercise bout. So this is endurance exercise, mostly cycling. And what we've done here is shown all the studies that have used biochemical extraction techniques. So that is taking a muscle biopsy and extracting the lipids from a muscle homogenate and measuring the triglyceride content. And I guess what you can see, the key things to take home from this are, but the response is, first of all, very variable. You see a range from a reduction of around 50% up to increases in 50 to 100% in on occasion. And also, the average change across all those studies is pretty close to zero, and just, in fact, just under. And a lot of these studies have failed to detect substantial decreases in intramuscular triglyceride with exercise. And we're not certainly the first to review this. And the explanation for this is really due to two potentially confounding factors. The first one being the contamination from intermuscular adipocytes. So here you can see that within skeletal muscle, there are individual, you can get infiltration of fatty tissue and get individual adipocytes, which are about the same size as the intramuscular, the muscle fibers. And if you can imagine, if you take a biopsy and there is some adipocyte contamination within that biopsy, then that's really going to markedly influence the lipid content that you measure with a biochemical extraction. Remember that we're actually just interested in the intramuscular lipid. So those are the lipid droplets that contain within the muscle fiber itself. The second potentially confounding factor is the fiber type specific response. And this is some old but classic work from Link Van Loon's lab, who showed that, first of all, we were the first to really assess lipid utilization in a fiber type specific manner using immunofluorescence microscopy. So they showed, first of all, that the type 1 fiber content lipid was 2 to 3-fold higher in type 1 fibers, but also the decline during exercise in response to exercise, this is sustained prolonged moderate intensity exercise, was specific to those type 1 fibers. So marked reduction in the type 1 fibers, but essentially no change in the type 2 fibers. So this is more data that we've reviewed, and these now including studies that have used either immunofluorescence microscopy or magnetic resonance spectroscopy. So a clear advantage of immunofluorescence microscopy is you can look at fiber type specific breakdown of intramuscular lipid. And you can see here across all those studies, there's a very clear and in some cases really substantial decline in intramuscular lipid content in response to exercise. So then some of these studies that have shown the largest decreases in type 1 fibers have been with prolonged exercise up to 3 hours in really well-trained subjects. When you look at the type 2 fibers, the response is clearly much lower. And I don't think there's a single study that has actually detected a significant decline in intramuscular lipid in the type 2 fibers. But you can see that when you accumulate these studies, there does seem to be a small effect, again, during prolonged exercise in the type 2 fibers, but certainly nowhere near to what you see in type 1 fibers. Looking at MRS, the advantage of this is, well, firstly, it's non-invasive, but also that you can eliminate the extra muscular sources of lipid. So, but you can't look at fiber type specific breakdown of lipid. So probably unsurprisingly, when you're looking at whole muscle, this sits somewhere between the average between the type 1 and the type 2 fibers. So I guess when you summarize this data like this, it's really illustrates the point that it's, if you're interested in measuring intramuscular lipid, particularly in relation to exercise, it's important to consider muscle fiber type composition, muscle fiber type specific effects. And this is, as I said, this is pretty well known, and a number of different labs have shown this and talked about this. But I think the implications are potentially much wider because, the lipid-induced insulin resistance story, there's a number of different types of lipid species that have been linked to development of muscle insulin resistance. But these are all done using whole muscle homogenates and analyzing lipid profiles using mass spec. And essentially none of these studies really are able to tease out the muscle fiber-specific lipid content from potential contamination from extramuscular sources, such as the intermuscular adipocytes. And that is particularly a problem when you examine insulin resistance, because we know that intermuscular adipocyte infiltration is particularly prevalent in obese and aging populations. And so far, I think this is potentially a limiting factor to these studies, and may explain why the story is far from clear around which type of lipids actually lead to the development of insulin resistance. Furthermore, I think it also has implications for lipid droplet-related proteins. So we now know that the lipid droplet is a functioning organelle. There's a really large range of proteins that have been linked to associate with the lipid droplet. These range from proteins that there's a plin family of proteins that are particularly strongly prevalent in lipid droplets and have been the focus of a lot of attention. But there's also proteins associated with synthesis of triglycerides. We know that the enzymes responsible for lipid breakdown, they translocate to the lipid droplet when activated. And also there's also a whole host of other proteins associated with other cellular functions. But it's important to remember that these lipid droplet-associated proteins are present in skeletal muscle, but they're also present on lipid, the majority of which are present on lipid droplets in other tissues, in particular adipocytes. So if you're interested in these proteins and you're getting contamination from intermuscular adipocytes, that could be a significant problem. And we've shown that at least some of these proteins that are associated with lipid droplet in muscle are also fiber type specific. So I think the same implications occur or should be considered when you're looking at these type of proteins. Okay, so moving on, I just wanted to present some of the more recent work that we've done in this area, where we want to look at specific impacts of endurance training and also considerations of fiber type on some of these muscle lipid related proteins. And we took quite a comprehensive approach after many discussions with Robin, and we used a combination of immunofluorescence microscopy and immunoblotting using Robin's techniques in both whole muscle and pulse single fibers. So in this study, we recruited a relatively small number, but we recruited an untrained group who were, an endurance training group. They were fairly well matched for age and BMI, but clearly the endurance training group had a significantly higher VO2 max. We first of all fiber type the muscle, and as you'd expect, the training group had substantially higher proportion of type 1 muscle fibers. We then looked at the intramuscular triglyceride content using immunofluorescence microscopy. So this is using the lipid diet body pie, which is a good marker of lipid droplets within the muscle. And you can see as many of us have shown previously, intramuscular lipid content is highly fiber type specific. We know that. And we saw a significantly greater abundance of intramuscular lipid in the trained individuals, particularly in the type 1 fibers. So this kind of, reiterates the athlete's paradox that with endurance training, you can actually increase your intramuscular lipid storage. We then went on to look at some of the fundamental lipid droplet proteins, in particular the PLIN family of proteins, starting off with PLIN2. So we used this measured PLIN2 abundance with immunofluorescence microscopy. And very similar to intramuscular lipid, we saw substantial fiber type specific effects with a 2 to 3-fold higher PLIN2 content in the type 1 fibers, but also substantial training effects. So it really mirrored the intramuscular lipid content. Furthermore, just to kind of, validate these findings in immunofluorescence, we also run Western blotting, this time on whole muscle, and we more or less represent show those findings again using this immunoblotting technique, which bordered on statistical significance. And I think it's interesting here that there's one subject here in the untrained group that had a very high PLIN2 abundance, actually higher than all of the trained subjects. And you can actually see this on the representative plot here. Despite very similar protein loading, they had a higher abundance of this PLIN2 in the untrained group. So I think this potentially one explanation for this could be some contamination, if there is contamination from intermuscular adipocytes. PLIN2 is ubiquitously expressed, so it's present in skeletal muscle and all other tissues, including adipocytes. So that could be one explanation for that, this kind of outlier in the data. We also looked at another lipid droplet protein, PLIN5, and we saw something very similar in terms of the fiber type specific abundance of PLIN5. And also a substantial training effect with a higher abundance in the trained group, which we again validated using immunoblotting. The data was much higher here, at least for the untrained group, and it's very important to bear in mind that PLIN5 is really only expressed in tissues with a high oxidative capacity, so skeletal muscle and primarily the heart, but not adipose tissue. So we then went on to look at some of the key lipolytic enzymes. And we're actually the first to use this quantitative immunoblotting to assess the abundance of both HSL and ATGL. We saw significant fiber type effects for both of these proteins, and you can see here similar, about twofold higher abundance, greater abundance of HSL and also ATGL in the type 1 muscle fibers. And interestingly, in some of the type 2 fibers, at least in the untrained group, the abundance of those proteins were barely detectable using Western blotting. We then followed that up in whole muscle and showed that the trained group actually had a greater abundance of both of these proteins. So I guess taken together, what we're really showing here is that it's important to consider fiber type specific differences in these lipid droplet related proteins. I think the training effect that you see when you look at whole muscle is really due to a combination of greater proportion of type 1 fibers, but also greater an upregulation of expression of these individual proteins. And we also think these muscle fiber type has implications for whole body metabolism. In this study, we also measured maximal fat oxidation rates in all of our subjects. And we actually found that one of the best correlators with maximal fat oxidation was actually the proportion of type 1 muscle fibers. And this was a similar correlation to VO2 max, which has been, I guess, one of the best predictors of maximal fat oxidation so far. So we think that perhaps some muscle derived factors may be important in contributing to the variability in maximal fat oxidation. We're currently doing more work in that area to further understand this relationship. So I guess to conclude, the first part, really, we've shown that assessing lipid-related outcomes in whole muscle could be problematic. And I think that's particularly the case when you're looking at inactive and overweight and perhaps older individuals. We know from previous work, intramuscular lipid metabolism is highly fiber type specific. And this seems to be due to a broad upregulation of lipid droplet related proteins in type 1 fibers that aid both storage of lipids and also the utilization during exercise. And we think the muscle fiber type composition probably influences whole body fuel selection during exercise. Okay, so just to move to the second part of the talk, which is focusing on autophagy. So this is a degradation system which removes dysfunctional cellular components. And we're not going into too much detail. There's three different types of autophagy, and they differ really depending on the mechanism at which the cellular components are targeted, but also delivered to the lysosome for degradation. So for this talk, I'm just going to focus on macroautophagy, which involves formation of an autophagosome here, which surrounds essentially the targeted cellular components and then delivers its cargo to the lysosome. We became interested in this because it's regulated by metabolic status. We know that macroautophagy is upregulated in periods of nutrient or lack of availability of nutrients. So in response to fasting, greater upregulation in response to starving. And there's recently there's data come out to show that it may be activated by exercise, and even important in the adaptive response to training. On the other hand, we know that feeding inhibits autophagy, primarily driven by increases in insulin and also amino acids. And I guess we really became interested in autophagy when it's more recently been shown to be, I guess, specific, but also some key autophagy targets could be key organelles related to metabolism, in particular the mitochondria and more recently lipid droplets, at least in the liver. So the question was then, for us, was are there any fiber type specific autophagy responses, particularly as lipids and mitochondria could be key autophagy targets? So first of all, thing to know is the autophagy pathway is really complex, and there's a whole host of proteins that are not included in this figure which contribute. And also, there's a challenge to measure autophagy, particularly in human skeletal muscle. But one of the key readouts for the rest of this talk is the importance of this protein LC3. So LC3 is essentially modified by addition of a phospholipid, phosphatidyl ethanolamine, which converts LC3-1 into LC3-2. And when LC3 is conjugated to this phospholipid, it becomes embedded in this growing membrane, which ultimately forms the autophagosome. So essentially LC3-2, the lipidated form, gives us at least an indication of the autophagosome content at any point in time. So in this study, we took muscle biopsies from some young sedentary males. First of all, measured the abundance of LC3. the different isoforms of LC3 in both type 1 and type 2 fibers. So you note here, we actually found substantial variability in the LC3-1 abundance, particularly in type 2 fibers. But on average, there was a greater abundance of LC3-1 in the type 2A fibers. But correspond alternatively, when you look at LC3B2, so this is the marker of autophagosome content, this was actually higher in the type 1 fibers, indicating that autophagosome content is higher in those type 1 muscle fibers. It's important to know that this doesn't mean that autophagy flux is higher in type 1 fibers, and it's really, I guess, a challenge in the area at the moment to measure autophagy flux, which doesn't seem to be possible in humans. So it's important to note that, but it does show that autophagosome content is different in fiber types. So we then wanted to look at trying and provide an explanation for this increase in LC3-2 in the type 1 fibers. So we picked apart some of the key steps in this autophagy pathway, looking at initially some proteins involved in autophagy initiation, proteins involved in the formation and expansion of the membrane, which forms the autophagosome, and then directly looking at some of the key proteins involved in this lipidation step. I'm moving through these pretty quickly, and you'll see why shortly, but when we looked at ULK1 involved in autophagy initiation, there were no differences between the fiber types. When we looked at ATG5, ATG12 involved in the expansion of the membrane, there were no differences. And then looking at ATG3 and ATG7, which key proteins involved in this lipidation step, there were no differences. So unfortunately, we're not any closer to really explaining why there's a greater lipidation of LC3 and a greater autophagosome content in type 1 fibers, something we're keen to explore in further detail. All right, just to finish off the last few minutes of this talk, is looking at the autophagy response to feeding in human skeletal muscles. So we know from animal studies that a prolonged fast, or prolonged, 24 hours plus, activates autophagy, and it's much lower in the fed state. There's relatively little being done in human skeletal muscle, particularly in response to a physiological stimulus. So we want to look at whether an acute feeding for a mixed meal challenge would actually alter the autophagosome response in muscle. And of course, we also wanted to look at the muscle fiber type specific effect. So in these individuals, these are again young males, who were sedentary young males, and they ingested a mixed meal after an overnight fast, and that elicited the kind of expected responses of glucose and insulin. And it also upregulated signaling pathways, which are insulin responsive and also amino acid responsive, and are upstream of the autophagy pathway, which suppresses the initiation of autophagy. So you can see that, as expected, we saw substantial increases in both phospho-AKT and phospho-mTOR. And this was similar in both fiber types. Interestingly, we did see a higher overall phospho-AKT in the type 2 fibers, and that was starting from baseline and across all samples. However, those changes didn't really impact the LC3. So when we looked at LC3-1, we saw this fiber type difference, which we saw at baseline, persist. So LC3-1 abundance was greater in the type 2 fibers across the 90 minutes. But there was no response to the meal, which is what we would expect given previous data on LC3-1. However, when we looked at LC3-2, we did see a main effect of the meal with declines in the LC3-2 at 90 minutes in both type 1 and type 2 fibers. So although there are differences in autophagosome content at rest, the responses between fiber types seems to be pretty similar. And this reduction in LC3-2, as I mentioned, is reflective of a reduction in autophagosome content, we think, or suppression of autophagy. Okay, so I guess to conclude, we've shown that the degree of LC3 phospholipid conjugation is different across muscle fiber types, and the autophagosome content is higher in type 1 fibers. The fiber type differences in LC3 lipidation don't seem to be due to the abundance, at least, of key autophagy-related machinery. We've also shown that autophagy is acutely suppressed after the ingestion of a single mixed meal, but seems to be similarly responsive in both type 1 and type 2 fibers. I guess if I was pushed to have a take-home message, well, I'd say that consideration of muscle fiber type is essential when examining intramuscular lipid metabolism, but also the related regulatory proteins. And secondly, although we can't explain the mechanisms, we've shown that at least autophagy in the fasted state appears to be different across fiber types. But I think we're you know, waiting for a better method to really to measure autophagy flux to really push this area forward, in, at least in human skeletal muscle in vivo. Okay, so thanks everyone for listening, and I think there might be time for a couple of quick questions before we hand over to Vicky.
Thank you, Chris. Can I start with that question? So yeah, you very nicely demonstrated the difference in the PLIN and the different membrane proteins and with the type fiber types, and also the effect of training, and there seemed to be a similar difference between the fiber types and the different proteins. So what's your take in terms of, do we just get more PLINs because there are more lipid droplets, or they expand? Or do we see a relative difference in the membrane composition of these proteins?
Yeah, I mean, my take is they seem to be pretty closely related. So I think you need that expansion of the perilipin proteins in order to, I guess, to maintain the regulatory kind of control over that lipid droplet. That's my take on it. We have some data that's in disease states that maybe there is some dysregulation there, and you might get a disconnect between the lipid content and the perilipin proteins, and which seems to maybe can be corrected by training. But I think at least in the data that I showed today, I think it's really just reflective of the intramuscular lipid content.
So you're suggesting that in terms of in detrimental function, that would decrease the amount of given specific perilipins or lipid proteins. But I was more thinking on in terms of functional going the other way. Do you think that we could have a relative difference in these content that would enhance function?
Okay. I mean, I think in theory, yeah, that sounds good. I think. I mean, you know, these proteins are necessary to recruit appropriate lipases and associated machinery. But showing that on the level of an individual lipid droplet is really challenging. So to get really strong data on that is tough, given the resolution you're working at with such a small lipid droplet. I know people are working on that, and they're making progress.
Okay. Thanks.
I could ask something, Chris. It's Robin. When you found that outlier, I wonder, is there a specific adipocyte protein that you could then put on that Western blot and identify whether or not it is?
Yeah, there is one protein, perilipin 1. Yeah, that isn't expressed in muscle, but is expressed in adipocytes. And yeah, that's something I've thought about. Particularly if you're looking at, like I said, if you're looking at an overweight, aging individual, and it'd be really interesting to see whether you can pick up any perilipin when you do a whole muscle assessment. And I know there are a few people who've kind of used that to kind of demonstrate that they don't have intermuscular adipocyte contamination in the biopsies.
Yeah, right.
A couple of times, but they're certainly not routinely.
Yeah, that'd be nice with the single fiber. Then you could just put it on afterwards and go, oh, yeah, that's one that – you might not have seen it under the microscope, but you can see it. So it would be a neat add-on there.
There's always more work to do.
Yeah, okay. I'm not afraid of work.
All right, I think it's time to hand over from me to Vicky. So Vicky Wickelsmer is a postdoctoral research fellow at the Karolinska Institute, and she's going to provide us some data, a bit of a change of track. And she's looking at how a muscle fiber type might modify a response to acute cold exposure. Okay, Vicky, what was your
okay. Thanks for the invitation to talk, and also well done to ACSS for getting this show up and running. So as Chris said, my talk is slightly different, and thanks to those guys for covering off all the background. But I'll be talking about fiber type how the fibre type can modify our response to cold. So the first thing I'd like to talk about is alpha-actin proteins. So they're sarcomeric proteins, and their main function in the muscle is to attach the thin actin filament to the Z-line, but they're also linked to other sort of cellular functions within the muscle cell or within the cell. So there are four alpha-actin proteins, but for the sake of skeletal muscle, only alpha-actin 2 and alpha-actin 3 are present. And as we can see here in this Western blot, that alpha-actin 2 is clearly expressed in every single fiber type that we have. So we can see we have a type 2X fiber here, that we have a clear amount of alpha-actin 2. Also for type 2A, 2X, and 2A only, and also type 1. But this is also not the case for alpha-actin 3, where it's clearly only expressed in our type 2X, type 2A, type 2X, and also type 2A. When we see a type 1 protein, then we see that there's no expression of alpha-actin 3 as well. The other thing that this Western blot will show you is that alpha-actin 3 is clearly not a specific protein, or it's not a necessary protein for our muscle function or our survival. And it's quite interesting in that 16 to 18% of the population worldwide, which is about 1.5 billion people, are actually deficient in alpha-actin 3 due to a stop codon happening at 0.577. And we don't exactly know why this happens, but one interesting feature of this 577X allele, so a lack of alpha-actin 3, is that it appears to be a positive selection for places of cold climates. So I think they've started to trace back, at least in Europe, this X allele from about 15,000 years ago. So how interesting that people in Scandinavia can tolerate these cold temperatures that Australians like me are not so good at. And also in East Asia, where there's a real high prevalence of this knockout or this X allele. But one of the main questions is what and for how? And there's been three kind of hypotheses that where this might be quite an advantage. One of these is suggested to be a resistance to famine. One is a resistance to cold. And the third is endurance, capacity for endurance exercise. And it is kind of known in the literature that, or at least hypothesized, that alpha-actin 3 guys, if you do not have alpha-actin 3, you're more likely to be better at endurance events. You're more likely to have a more oxidated muscle phenotype. Conversely, if you do have alpha-actin 3, then you're definitely going to be a much better sprinter. So it is also known for the gene for speed, one would say. But this presentation is really, we're really interested in the resistance to cold. And so to test this, we recruited 27 guys who do have actin 3 and 15 guys without it, and we put them through a whole body cold water immersion. And before this, we were able to take a biopsy, but unfortunately, we couldn't get a muscle biopsy after. But this cold water protocol involved 14-degree water bath, where they sat in the water bath and only their head was allowed above the surface. So they stayed in this bath for 20 minutes at a time. Then they were allowed out for 10 minutes, and they just sat at room temperature. Then they went in for 20 minutes, out for 10, and they repeated this until their rectal temperature reached 35.5 degrees. Or they completed 2 hours of sitting in the bath. So 2 hours of sitting in the bath, and then, so 170 minutes if you include all the pauses and all the breaks. And the first thing that we found is that the guys who could actually tolerate, and this is a survival curve of the guys who actually finished the cold exposure, and we can see in the alpha-actin 3 knockout people that about 75% of them could actually finish the immersion without their temperature dropping to a dangerous level, whereas the guys who do express it, less than 50, closer to 30% of those guys actually finish the protocol. So there's a clear advantage to not having alpha-actin 3 when you're sitting in a cold bath. We looked at the rate of temperature decline, which is clearly lower in the knockout humans, and also in the muscle temperature decline. The only thing that wasn't different was the rate of decline in the skin temperature. We also looked at some basic physiological responses, and we found that both the knockouts and the guys with alpha-actin 3 had an equal response in heart rate, and they also had an equal response in respiration measured by VO2, VCO2. So from this perspective, it didn't seem like there was any sort of acute stressful responses that could have led to this stark difference. we had a look at their body composition as well. And apart from the XX guys being slightly older, we found no difference between any other characteristics of the subject. So body weight was the same, body surface area means skin fold thickness was basically the same, or was the same, and body mass index also. And also core temperatures at the start were also identical. So then we thought, okay, then we need to look into the muscle a little bit more. And one of the main reasons our lab's quite interested in this is because it was heavily around calcium cycling. And calcium cycling is highly linked with heat generation. And a study from 10 years ago from our lab showed that cold-adapted mice had an increased intracellular calcium concentration. So they had calcium leaking from the sarcoplasmic reticulum out into the myoplasm. And when this happens, calcium can be taken up by other cellular organelles, and that can lead to an increase in mitochondrial biogenesis. And what happens when these just normal wild-type mice were cold-adapted, they found they had a more oxidative phenotype, they're more fatigue resistant, and they, so that's also a common feature of alpha-actinin 3. So we're kind of trying to put a link here. The other thing that's quite particular about cycling, calcium cycling heat generation is the circa heat generation itself. So for circa to be able to put calcium back into the sarcoplasmic reticulum, it hydrolyzes ATP. And as Robin alluded to earlier, it uses quite a lot of ATP to be able to do this. The hydrolysis of ATP is quite a taxing process, and it, as a consequence, you get a lot of heat produced. More specific to alpha-actinin 3, under normal basal conditions, circa uptake and the calcium leak have been shown to be far higher in an alpha-actinin 3 knockout mouse. And this was also linked to a higher density of calcium regulatory proteins. So with this in mind, we were curious to see how the circa proteins differed between our alpha-actinin 3 knockout people and our people who do express it. So the first thing we did was we looked at these calcium proteins on a whole muscle level. And the first one we looked at was circa-1, the fast expressed circa isoform, which is more abundant than the guys with alpha-actinin 3. Then the second protein we looked at was the circa-2, the slow, which is more expressed in the knockouts. So then we went back and we said, checked calcium expressions, one of the faster isoforms, which is also pretty much higher in the RR group, compared then to the slow calsequestrin isoform, which again was more highly expressed in the XX guys, so the people without alpha-actinin 3. And the only common thing that we could draw here was that the proteins that are expressed in type 1 fibers, so your calsequestrin 2 and your circa 2, were more abundant in our knockouts, and our circa 1 and our calsequestrin were more expressed in the guys who do have alpha-actinin 3. So to figure out what was going on here, we ran a silver stain. And our silver stain we use like where you run a piece of homogenate through a gel for 20 hours or so, and then you stain for the different mice and isoforms. So we ended up finding that on this silver stain gel, we had the guys who do not have alpha-actinin 3, so our XX, had a way higher proportion of type 1 fibers, and they had way less type 2X fibers compared to our guys without alpha-actinin 3. Interesting, no difference here between mice and heavy chain 2 isoforms. So then we wanted to look a bit more broadly again on the muscle to see what we could find, if there's anything else that might elucidate to these changes in a single fiber level, on a temperature level, so what's actually happening. So we sent the muscle off for mass spectrometry. And what we found when we looked at mass spectrometry is we found that over 600 proteins were differentially expressed. But what this graph figure on the right shows is the fold change difference between the XX and the RR. And what we can see when we look at the left side, so the negative fold increase, the negative fold change, is that proteins such as fast switch proteins, so actinin 3 and a few others that are mainly expressed in fast switch muscle fibers, are far less compared to mice and light chain, for example, mice and heavy chain 1, circa 2, and a few others. So from this perspective, the only really thing that really stood out from the proteomics out of 600 different proteins was it really was heavily linked to a slow oxidative phenotype of the muscle. So then we wanted to see in single fibers if there was any differences. So as the first two speakers have pointed out quite clearly, that you should always check the single fibers if you have a bit of an alteration in your fiber type proportion to see if we weren't missing any other real findings happening on this level. And what we found was quite standard, that we found that our fast twitch muscle proteins had a higher abundance of in type 2 fibers compared to type 1, but we found no difference here between any of these interventions. When we looked at the slow twitch muscle fibers, we also saw that there was an increase in the type 1 compared to the type 2, and only in the circuit 2 did we find that actually the guys who do have alpha actin N3 who really struggled to maintain their body temperature actually had more circa in their slow twitch fibers. So we were also a little bit confused by this, and that kind of also went against what we thought. So we then decided to look for sarcolipin. Looked at sarcolipin. So sarcolipin regulates circa, it uncouples circa, which means you have less calcium being transported into the SR by circa, but you're still hydrolyzing the same amount of ATP. So you're still generating a lot of heat. We didn't find any difference on a whole muscle level to indicate any sort of differences in circa activity. And then we also didn't find anything on a single fiber level. We found that there was more in the type 2 than the type 1, but this was not different between genotypes. And our final measure here was an immunoprecipitation between reendering receptor and the FKBB12 protein. So the FKBB12 is kind of like the doorman, essentially. So when that opens up, the reendering receptor can let out the calcium. And so if you have sort of an alteration in the ratio between these two groups, it might indicate that the reendering receptor is a little bit more open and a little bit more leaky. And in this case, we didn't see anything on that either. So at least in resting muscle, from this perspective, we couldn't figure out, we didn't think from a calcium perspective that this was the cause of our heat production. But then the role of brown adipose tissue we knew would come up, and we couldn't get brown adipose tissue from our people, obviously. So we enlisted some help of Pete Halley, who's a senior researcher in Melbourne at Murdoch Children's Research Institute. And he had a study using alpha-actinin knockout mice and wild-type mice, and they were either put in a fridge for 5 hours. In this instance, I'm sure they've taken the beer out first, or they've gone into a thermoneutral condition for mice for 20 hours. After each mouse had finished their intervention, they were sacrificed and the brown adipose tissue was extracted and was analyzed by RNA sequencing. And so the first figure here shows that basically the time to reach 35.5 is way slower or in the knockout mice. So the knockout mice here have a far better tolerance also to the temperature. If we go straight down to panel E, this shows us that the alpha-actinin 3 in the bat is expressed in wild type, but there's obviously no alpha-actinin 3 in the knockout bat. We look at this principal component analysis, and it shows here that we have an effect of the temperature per se, but it doesn't seem to be any effect of the genotype. As you can see, there's different colors and different shapes kind of all over the shop in no consistent pattern. But then when we took into account the genotype and temperature comparison, out of 2,000 genes, we only found one that had the effect of genotype and temperature. So from this, we were pretty confident to say that while BAT might have been activated or BAT was activated, there's no way that it could have influenced the temperature regulation in these mice. Our last little piece of data was to look at the involuntary activation of motor units. And so we put EMGs on the volunteers, the human volunteers who are in the water. And what we can see here in our representative trace is that the RR guys, so the guys with actinin 3, have this kind of like burst, like, so they have little bouts of low intensity and then they have quite rapid bouts of high intensity activity interspersed with all their low intensity activity. Where you see with all the XX guys, the knockouts, that they have a nice low intensity activity throughout the cold water immersion. and that you can see that in their burst rate. And this also, because of these high intensity bursts, that they also have a slightly higher, I would say, higher frequency of muscle contraction doing a thing throughout the cold. But this wasn't because of any additional motor units being recruited. And what's interesting is that in the literature, this sort of continuous low intensity activity is being well associated with the proportion of type 1 fibers. And this is this sort of high intermittent bursting sort of contraction is being well linked with type 2 fibers. And so our hypothesis is that they're, the fact that these guys have such high amounts of slow twitch fibers and they can maintain this low intensity activity, so we call it muscle tone, they can maintain this tone under cold conditions, means they don't have to produce as much energy. And they're probably able to better tolerate the cold because they're also less, these muscle fibers are less likely to fatigue as fast. So our take-home messages from this were that the alpha-actin 3 genotype modified the skeletal muscle function during cold exposure. Individuals lacking alpha-actin 3 clearly shift to a slow muscle phenotype, which we could demonstrate through through silver staining, through Western blotting, and through proteomics. A superior cold tolerance is likely caused by the prolonged muscle tone of the slow muscle versus the bursting that happens with more fast muscle fibers. And I think one of the key ones, which is of most relevance for this symposium, is that when you're studying skeletal muscle, clearly in these alpha-actin 3 individuals, if you're looking at a training or sort of long-term skeletal muscle intervention, that this homogenate diet is clearly going to be influenced by the type 1 dominance in these individuals. Just to thank everyone at KI who was involved in this paper in particular from the lab, and then also the rest of the lab members, our collaborators at Lithuanian Sports University, who do really great work with human volunteers, and also Children's Research Institute for all the help with the animal component of the work. And I probably am a bit under time, but that's fine.
I appreciate that, Vicky, as chair. thanks, that was a really fascinating talk. One of my main questions was how you get volunteers to volunteer for that intervention.
I think money.
This is a naive question around, we talk about muscle tone, does that have any relation to shivering? What's the shivering? How does that relate to shivering?
Yeah, so I think it's just like a nod. So I think shivering is when you have like the muscle, it's like a low level shivering basically. So when you shiver too much, then you're going to start to, your muscle's going to contract and make heat. But this is, it's kind of like a level under that. So it's kind of, my understanding of it's just a very low basal. So you're producing heat, but you're not taking a lot of energy up, I suppose. And you're not fatiguing yourself, and you've always got fuel coming in because you're just, I mean, you're probably using all your fat, type 1 fiber, so you've probably got a lot more fat oxidation happening in these situations as well, I would say.
Okay. So I think Robin has a question.
I do. That was a great talk, Vicky. Thank you very much. I'm thinking about the calcium release, and you've shown that your bursts are happening, and it seems that they're not electrical for the XX guys who can tolerate the cold. So there must be something else going on. And so I'm thinking about the other things that can control calcium release. So FKBP12 is not different in terms of its association with the ranitidine receptor, but you can also get retrograde leak coming out of the circuit pump. And one of the mechanisms for that is increased ADP. And so I wonder whether you have considered whether your metabolite concentration might be different in these individuals. ADP fluxes and it doesn't stay up for very long. But is that something that you've thought about? Have you got any comment around that as a mechanism?
We haven't thought about it. That's a very good point. We also think that potentially there could be something more calcium happening, but we don't have the post-cold sort of biopsy. So for us, that's kind of like our limitation, that we can't We can't do these sort of experiments after they've finished the cold state. Ideally, we would like to do it in mice and then use our intacts, but we can't get the ethics to do these experiments at KI. But we're working on ethics at KI to put the mice in the freeze. So, yeah, it potentially is, but I mean, also it's very clearly like neuronally driven as well from a contraction point of view.
Yeah, but you could get some mechanism happening internally. And so the other question is around magnesium. And is magnesium a little bit lower, which could be related to an ATP, ADP? Maybe it's just worth having a chat back at the lab with those calcium experts on that too. Thanks. Definitely. Nice talk.
Thanks.
Thanks. Your question?
Yeah, please. Thank you. Thank you for a very nice talk, Victoria. Really interesting. I have a couple of questions. So one of them, what was your rationale for choosing, I think it was 14 degrees cold water? Why that? Why not colder or why not longer? I mean, it was a very long duration in that water, and I agree with Chris.
14 degrees is kind of standard for, for athletic ice baths and everything like this. But it's also, I think it's been piloted a few different times in that lab, and 14 degrees is kind of the coldest they could go that they could tolerate for that 2 hour period.
Impressive. So thanks. The other question is, you showed this distribution across the world with the difference, and as far as I know, there's a distribution also, or there is, of the mitochondrial haplotypes, and part of the speculation of that is also different capacities to survival with the mitochondrial haplotypes. Do you have any idea of whether this co-distributes with this particular mutation or knockout, if as you call it, the different haplotypes?
Mutation would have been a better word than knockout. We've started to look at a few different mitochondrial proteins within the single fibers to see if there's any sort of differences there. It's so far looking like maybe the type 2A fibers are the ones actually that have the difference in mitochondrial protein abundances rather than anything else, but it's still ongoing. So.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So what's the next step?
Next step. Try to be able to repeat this in mice and then to do it in single fibers for calcium measurements.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, Nikki. I also had another question. I might have got this wrong, so just do correct me. Robin showed that they couldn't really find type 2X fibers are very rare from what the data that Robin showed, but did I get it right that you saw quite a reasonable abundance of 2X, mycin heavy chain 2X protein, is that right?
In the silver stain, yes. Dissecting and doing dot blotting and trying to differentiate them from type 2A is not as successful. We got some, definitely, but in the silver stain it looked easier than what it was practically.
But is there an explanation why you don't tend to see them with single fiber dissections, but when you look at the whole muscle, there's plenty of that myosin heavy chain isoform there.
Robin, I don't know. Sometimes it's luck of the draw. I mean, some subjects there were a lot and others not so much.
It's an interesting one because it is something that we've considered a lot if you look at the cross section and you see that they're, you know, it's a mosaic appearance. So when you're sitting at the microscope and you're taking the fibers out and you guys have sat there and done this, the question is, you know, do you just not take some of the fibers? And I think that the consensus is that no, we would take nearly every fiber that comes out. Some might be a bit more brittle, but that's the sample, not a given fiber. So we tend to think that we aren't being biased when we take samples from that biopsy. And that's, as I said, that's a bit of a consensus there. So it does make me wonder whether the antibody, because the 2X antibody is pretty difficult to get to, it's finicky. It's finicky in a Western. In the dot blotting, it works. In the Western, it's not nearly as good. And so, Vicky, what you showed with the silver staining, it perhaps makes me think that we really need to use, you know, well, silver staining is ideal, very, very, very laborious, the silver staining. but using the dot plotting and identifying it qualitatively and not relying on the full gel separation is probably where we need to maybe head to really know whether or not we're getting the two X's, because it's a really good point that you make. And why is it that we only found them when we went to our cancer patients, not the others, on a regular basis anyway? But as Vicky said, sometimes there's one person and they have lots of 2X fibers. I assume that they must have actinin and 3 as well, Vicky, if that was the case, do you think?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Right. We still have a couple of minutes remaining, I think. So I guess I'll just open up a question to the panel. We've all covered Western blotting in single fibers, and I guess my question to you is, you know, where do you see the next step? Is it more Western blotting on individual proteins? Is the next step proteomics? And then if you were starting to do this in proteomics and single fibers, then where does that leave Western blots? Robin, you have any thoughts?
Yes, absolutely. And it's something that I've thought a lot about. When the first paper came out using proteomics in single fibers, I was very excited. I'd had attempted it once and I only got about 300 proteins come out in my single fibers. So it's like, well, I know that there's lots more fibers, a lot more proteins there. So the hit rate wasn't very high. I think one of the limitations of proteomics is that just because a protein isn't present doesn't mean it's not in muscle. And that's the conundrum that you can't be sure. And I know of a number of proteins that we find in muscle in single fibers when we do Western blotting, but when I do even whole muscle and I pick a band out, well, I don't see it with mass spec. So my concern with it is that you will miss, if you're trying to see a particular protein, if you're trying to see the big picture of everything that might be happening, proteomics is not the way to go. But if you really want to start to understand, like what Vicky showed, I think, with the proteomics data, if you want to say, is there anything going on, then you do get a broad picture, and then you can maybe go in and pick out some of those proteins and say, well, what is it that you do? So in a discovery sense, that's where you go. But if you really want to go mechanisms, then I can't see that that's at the point yet that you can get all the answers with proteomics. It can't be quantitative in the same sense. I've had some discussions with people who swear by mass spec and they're, oh, no, it's totally quantitative, but I haven't seen how the quantitation can be done yet. You don't spark your sample and come up with this particular answer. So I'd like to keep watching the space, and I'd like someone to be doing it and to see where we head. And I think that that's got to stay on the radar of single fibers and proteomics. And Vicky, you've got data on it now, so I'm interested to see what you're thinking these days around that as a tool.
Yeah, we're trying RNA-seq for single fibers at the moment, but we're at more at the isolating, making sure we have enough RNA and all these sorts of things stage at the moment. So we'll keep you posted.
I do say that when we're challenged with something like that, like getting enough sample to do something, that's when I think it's always good to go back to the books and go, well, what is it? What is it that I'm trying to answer here? And because the person in the mass spec facility says, oh, you must have 10 milligrams, I mean, I'll just laugh at them and say, no, there's got to be another way. So that's when I've gone in and said I want to look at things at a very, very small level, people laughed at the ability of being able to do this, but I just thought there's got to be a way. And so I think that if someone's keen to do it, rather than accepting that you have to use 10 milligrams of muscle to do this, challenge that and go, well, why would it be that I would need that much, and work backwards and enter it from this, I haven't got that. That's not where I'm going to start. I'm going to start low and build up. And that's when, you know, you can really make some amazing discoveries. And I think we're on the edge of being able to do that. if people have got the time and the money to do that type of thing.
Right. Thanks, Robin. I'm getting the signal to wrap up, so I'd better do that. Thanks again, Robin, Vicky and Jorn, and hope everyone enjoys the rest of the conference. Okay.
And thank you, Chris, for chairing and your talk also, and Jorn and Vicky. Thanks.
Thank you.
And everyone for being here.
Thank you.